and we will take you inside the auto industry like never before. And when I say we, I mean my very good digital as well as real-time buddies and friends in Detroit, Michigan, Mr. Frank Washington, bumper to bumper. That's not bumper to bumper. That's Greg Morris. Frank, I'm starting off the show wrong, man. Frank Washington, aboutthatcar.com. Nothing's changed in the last 2 weeks. We have Greg Morrison out in L.A. We're going to get a special report. Greg is Bumper to Bumper TV out in L.A. Greg's been attending the L.A. Auto Show, so we're going to get some comments from Greg on some of the products that he saw out there, some of the things I've been reading about, want to ask some questions. And we have our PhD sitting in Hotlanta by himself since Greg's on the road, Mr. Chris Lawrence, Auto Academics. I want to thank
right,
you guys.
Right now it's cold, Atlanta.
Oh, Colana, okay.
Warm it up before I get back, Chris. I ain't going for that.
I want to thank all of you for tuning in to today's show. I hope you had a safe and happy Thanksgiving. Hope you didn't eat too much turkey and get stuffed like a turkey. I'm going to try and pull this up on my phone here to see if we're actually live on YouTube.
We are live. It looks like.
Oh, okay.
You got it?
I don't know. It's coming up. Let's see. This technology is something else, boy. Hey, Greg, you can have Alvin and go give him your link, and he can join in on his smartphone if he has it with him.
Okay, well, let me see what I can do there.
If he wants to do that without making causing too many problems here, we can't be walking him through it how to do it. But anyway, we have some great big news for the last couple of weeks. I mean, the auto industry has just been going crazy. First, I want you to subscribe to the show since you're sitting there on YouTube watching this live, or if you're watching the replay, click on the subscribe button. You can also find us on blackpressusa.com. Go over there and check us out under transportation. You'll see Auto Network on Black Press USA. The big news, folks. As you all know, Carlos Ghosn, CEO of Nissan, was caught with his hand not in the till. He was caught trying to keep his hand out of the till and hide some funds, from what I understand from the different reports. He's no longer the CEO of Nissan, nor now Renault. So there's some big turnover there at Nissan as to what they're going to do. As you all know, he really saved Nissan from going under several years ago, and he's been, I guess, reported as being probably the most important person from the car company side in the industry when it comes to CEOs and some of the things that he's done on the innovative side. But he's now no longer with Nissan. If you haven't been watching the news, then you probably missed General Motors, and Frank can probably talk a little bit more about this since he's right there in Detroit, and hopefully he has his pulse on the heartbeat of what's happening with GM. It looked like GM may close 5 plants and lay off an unknown number of executives, as well as, I guess, hourly employees. Frank, here, can you kind of update us on what's happening with GM?
Well, in terms of what I know, is that I think earlier this year, GM engaged in a buyout of its white-collar employees. They were trying to get 18,000, yeah, I think it was 18,000 people to take the buyouts, and told them, at least in terms of what reports, they told them that if they didn't get the 18,000, fire some people, pretty much, or lay them off, or reduction in force in terms of, as they say. But anyway, they only got 2,000 people to take it. So GM did what they said they were going to do. They basically they closed, I think it's 5 plants, which involves roughly 6,500 blue collar workers. And then they did white collar workers, and basically they laid off, or they're going to lay off, something like 12,000 of them. So, and the thing about it is, this was, they made this announcement, I guess it was, yeah, it was this week. So in essence, they made this announcement, not in essence, in fact, they made this announcement right after Thanksgiving and right before Christmas. I was just thinking today that it's another, I won't say gaffe, but at least public relations gaffe, in a long line of such gaffes where GM does these sort of things in terms of layoffs and so on and so forth, which might be necessary from a business standpoint. But they, you know, not that it's a great time, but there are better times to do this. Someone might make the argument that, gee, they could have at least waited after the first of the year, you know, and done this. But who knows what's happening, you know, in the executive suite. You know, maybe they needed to do it now or thought about doing it now because it was better to end the in the year with their stock price higher. Because, you know, of course, normally with these things, when these things happen, the stock price goes up. And GM stock price did go up on this. But I will say that in terms of some of the things I've read, Mary Barra is basically doing what a long line of GM CEOs have refused to do. And that's right-size the company and do it basically all at once. There's been a little bit of this, you know, a little pinch here, you know, kind of like a pinch and a snip here, that sort of thing. But, you know, basically what she's doing is right-sizing the company and getting products in line with what the market is doing. Because one of the things that that was I don't know if it was underreported, but hardly mentioned, was that these plants that GM is closing, all of them produce cars. You know, there are no sport utilities, no crossovers, no pickups involved in this. They all produce cars, and that's what they did or doing.
You know, one of the side effects of what's happening in the industry since EVs, electric vehicles now look like that's going to be the future for the auto industry, whether it's full size tractor trailer, 18 wheelers, which Tesla's doing some testing, all the way down to scooters, you know. And we don't think about it when it comes to cars and trucks and vans and crossovers or whatever you want. When you go all electric, there are a lot of parts that you don't need anymore, like transmissions,
right. I mean, mufflers,
engines. I mean,
yeah,
I hadn't even thought about that.
Yeah, there's a lot of stuff you don't need.
There's a lot of parts in automobile, you know, in these cars, especially when you go all electric, that won't be needed anymore.
Yeah, because I think what Greg mentioned is awfully important, you know, when he said mufflers.
Yeah.
You know, basically, that's one item. But when you say mufflers, you're talking about the whole exhaust system.
Right.
You know? Which means you don't have to worry about catalytic converters anymore.
None of that.
Headers
and the industry that goes with it.
Yeah.
Not to go with right.
No more muffler repair.
Yeah.
By the way, I don't know if you're aware of this, but Dan Ammann, the president of GM,
yeah,
is stepping down as of January 1st.
I didn't hear that.
He's going to become today, CEO yeah. of the Cruise Autonomous Vehicle Unit.
Right.
GM unit?
Yeah.
Okay.
So some execs are given the door. Some guys are given the golden parachute.
Right.
Exactly.
Well, yeah. See, that's another part of the announcement that I won't say gets underplayed, but, you know, just a big hit in terms of the layoffs and so on and so forth. That was like the front page news. But on page 5, as he was saying, GM said that, you know, they expected to save something like $6 billion. And they said that in 2020. That's 12 months from now, or we're right. 15, you know. And one of the things they said was they plan to invest in automated cars and electronic or electric car technology and autonomous car technology. And that's a major restructure. Go ahead, I'm sorry.
This didn't set well. What GM is doing obviously didn't set well with Washington, D.C. So there's been some back and forth bickering as to what's going to happen with tariffs and some other things, some retaliatory effects that DC may want to leverage on GM, but you can't just leverage that on GM without affecting all the other manufacturers as well. And Ford took a different approach. You know, Ford says they're not laying off people. They're closing some plants and they're moving people around. They're giving people the opportunity to move and assume jobs at another plant. I think they took that low-key approach because of the heat that General Motors has taken. And I think once it gets off the front page, Ford will probably be the next one to start laying people off. So,
well, what Ford did, to think about it, when they shut down the Mercury division and they've been trimming back in bodies for the last 6-7 years, you know, they sort of took their poison pill early and got it over with.
Well, they just announced that they're closing some plants, but they're moving people around. They won't lose their job. Yeah.
So. You know, here's some numbers to play with. In 1978, General Motors had 600,000 employees. They were the largest private employer in the nation. Today, their staffing is about at 100,000 employees. You know, between robotics, automation, you don't need that many people. Yeah. And when you make that big a cut, like you're talking 12,000 people or so, in your executive ranks, that tells me that the company was way too top heavy.
Exactly.
Way too many executives in charge of executives in charge of the washroom.
Well, and speaking of executives, let's move right along so Greg, we can get into Greg's portion of the show today, which I'm looking forward to. There's a couple of promotions. William Lee has been appointed the interim president of Hyundai, and Robin Denham is Elon Musk's new boss. She's now the chairman of Tesla. So that's going to be interesting to see what happens with Tesla. And I look at Tesla as changing the industry and bringing a lot of what's happening now with other car companies, what they're trying to do to compete in this global world. But I think Tesla has demonstrated that, hey, we can do some things to and shake up the industry. And people may not want to believe it, or you didn't want to believe it up front. But the way that Tesla's going is not the wave of the future, it's now. And everybody's scrambling to take advantage of that now situation. So, go ahead, Frank.
If I could, you know, Tesla is doing the same thing to the industry that Toyota did, say, a decade or a decade and a half ago, and that is electrification. Basically, Toyota, through the Prius, dragged the entire industry into hybrid cars, you know, because there was a fairly sizable chunk of the public who cared about the environment, who cared about, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Okay, because something else flashed on my screen. Who cared about the,
that's all right.
That, who cared about the, what am I thinking? The environment, so on and so forth, and sales took off. And it got to the point where in order to be thought of and to have sales, in hybrids and be thought of as caring, a company caring about the environment, you had to have a hybrid, you know, if not one, at least two or three, that sort of thing. And Tesla has done the same thing, but they did it on the luxury level because the Tesla is a luxury car, just in terms of a price standpoint. Basically, if you remember, it was most, particularly the Germans, who basically started coming up with ways to compete with Tesla's electric cars. First of all, they did hybrids. They rushed and did the hybrids, plug-in hybrids, and that sort of thing. So Tesla, even if they go away, basically can be credited with bringing electrification to the auto industry a lot quicker than it would have been.
Exactly. Greg.
Yo.
Tell us a little bit about how the show opened. I know you're out there in L.A. I didn't make it this year. So talk a little bit about what's going on.
Okay, well, first of all, BMW kicked off things with the first press conference on Tuesday. And what you're looking at is the iVision 8 concept. This is an electric autonomous vehicle that is a concept now. But they're saying we'll be ready with this puppy within 3 years. By 2025, it'll be on the road. 2025 isn't that far away. As Frank is pointing out, time is moving fast. BMW was quite proud of that. They also showed off a new 3 Series sedan, which is on the screen here, as well as the new X7. So they were just rolling along. And then Toyota had to, you know, do their thing as well. By the way, Jack Hollis is now the big dog at Toyota. And, you know, there's some things going on there. But for BMW, you know, this is a way of saying, we're not even going to mess with hybrid anymore. We're going to offer you pure electric vehicles or continue to offer internal combustion engines. And proudly proclaiming that the X7 will be built in Greenville, South Carolina, and proudly saying, hey, this 3 Series, which has been our global leader, will be around for at least one more generation, if not two. Earlier, a moment ago, you had a shot of Jack Hollis up in front of the Toyota Corolla hybrid.
I think I dropped that, but let me see if I can find it right quick. Where is it? Where is it? Where is
it? I don't know. Okay.
Ah, got you in it. Which one is it? Is it this one? Oh, that's BMW.
That's Jack right there.
That's it there. There we go.
And Toyota, think about it. The Corolla finally getting a hybrid platform. As you say, Frank, Toyota is the brand that dragged the rest of the industry toward hybrids. Kicking and screaming they went. Now, you know, you think hybrid, you think Toyota. I recently had an opportunity to drive a Avalon hybrid, and I had to think about it. This is a big car. And it gets 44 miles to the gallon, you know, city driving. You know, who'd have thunk it? Toyota also said, we're not finished with hybrids, and they're not just, you know, meek little rides anymore. They showed off the all-wheel drive Prius. That's right, a Prius that, in theory, can go a little off-road, maybe on the grass, not quite over the mountains. But they're, you know, staking their claim there while still working on their electric platform through the Mirai. But it was interesting because the dealers who were there were just jumping for joy. A hybrid Corolla along with a new platform, a regular Corolla, and this is the Prius all-wheel drive. And it is a plug-in.
A
plug-in hybrid.
Okay.
So think about that. We're talking a tectonic change in the landscape of the industry. You know, Chris, I thought about you on this. I know how much you like to go bike riding up in the mountains. You know, so in theory, you could have one of these go on one of them slick roads up in North Georgia, no problem, put your bikes on the roof and do your 15, 20 miles and then take yourself straight to the emergency room for your treatment.
Exactly. I was about to say. Yeah. Hey, Greg, I was waiting for him to put up a picture of one of his tumbles. We haven't seen one of those
yet. Yeah, no, you won't see those.
He's riding some nice bikes now. I don't know. They may have training wheels on them. Who knows?
No, I think they have an emergency unit following him. You know.
Yeah. Chris has been riding some expensive bikes, boy, with all the safety gear. I'm proud of you.
And as they're making the presentation, they were talking about that lifestyle, you know, owner that wants to enjoy the Prius, but wants something that's a little more rugged or a little more capable than just driving on pavement. So, you know, they're smart. They're literally expanding their footprint and, you know, telling the rest of the world, catch up with us if you dare. Not if you can, if you dare.
You know, I'm surprised at the BMW, Greg. Did they have the scooter? Doesn't BMW have an electric scooter?
Yeah, they do, but they didn't show any bikes at this year's show. They showed primarily vehicles. Okay. Now, this is something that the Jeep fans are loving, the Gladiator truck. Yes,
Frank,
Jeep is
Frank, making we've got to get on the launch for this one, Frank, so we can do our on-the-road show. Take the doors off. The top comes off. Go ahead, and Greg.
This thing is extreme. It's basically a Rubicon with a long a cargo bed and, you know, Rubicon capability with everything else. And Jeep is extremely proud of this because think about it. How long has it been since we've seen the Jeep pickup? I'm thinking back to the Honcho, you know, which I know is probably predating many of us who want to admit our age. But the fans were there and they're passionate about it.
Oh,
and by the way, I found him.
He found him.
How is he?
Ron is doing well. For those who were wondering what has happened to Ron, it's not that he doesn't love us. Ron lives in Northern California and is a volunteer firefighter. And for the last few weeks, in fact, the last 2 months, he's been doing air support control.
Okay.
For the fighting the California wildfires. And we talk about the first responders. Ron is one of them. His son and his grandson are also first responders. So I want to salute them for their service and their efforts to protect their communities.
Definitely. We don't hold anything against Ron. I'm glad Ron is doing something that's helping people. He's been a volunteer fireman as long as I've known him, and he's been very, very proud of the fact that he is. So I applaud Ron and his family for doing that.
You know, we were talking earlier about electric cars. Well, guess who's going electric in a big way? Kia. This is the fully electric Kia Niro. Hmm. They're not taking any prisoners at that side either. And it's worth noting that Kia's had literally a major change in their upper management in the last 6 months. All new faces. They're bringing in the director of Kia UK to be president of Kia US. Mm-hmm. And they're, again, a group that is going hammer and tong. And they're saying, look, a lot of folks want to do SUVs and crossovers. We can get that. We've got those. Oh, and by the way, we also have a full line of sedans. So they're not abandoning the sedan market. If anything, they're picking up like a percentage point a year in sedan sales. So it is an interesting time. While domestic automakers seem to be running away from sedans, brands like Kia and Hyundai and some of the other imports are saying, oh, leave it to us. We'll take good care of you there.
Correct me if I'm wrong, Greg. Did they announce that this has like a 239-mile range?
Yeah, that's what I was getting ready to say. 240-mile range. You know, think back when the Leaf first came out, it was a 60-70-mile range, and now it's 150. And now we're up to 239 miles. But I got one better than that for all of you. Rivian.
Who?
Rivian.
Oh.
They built trucks. But before we get there.
We'll get to Rivian, I hope. You sent me a picture, right?
Yes, I did.
All right.
This is the Mazda hatchback 3. Version of the new Mazda 3.
Ooh, that looks good.
Now, this is one of those love it or hate it cars. Some people loved it. Some people hated it. But Mazda is committed to it. They're committed to internal combustion engines for a while. But they're probably going to come up with some electric platforms. They're just sort of dancing around the question right now. And they've tried to make this Skyactiv platform a lot more responsive. Tighter, they're talking about tighter suspension and so forth. And for them, this is their global platform. You can go almost anywhere on the planet and find a Mazda that looks like this, and people will buy them and drive them into the ground. And of course, I had to go to the Nissan party because, I mean, these are the guys who sort of broke ground with the electric platforms in this country. And the interesting thing is, obviously, you see a Nissan Leaf there. Nissan did one of their events here in Los Angeles at the Japanese-American World War II Museum.
Hmm.
Perfect setting, great venue, but they're really pushing their intelligent mobility, driver assist technology, pushing the envelope to get to autonomous driving, probably pushing the rest of the industry along with them, saying, well, ours can do this, ours can do that. And they're really putting some pressure on folks. So do not be surprised if you see more ProPilot, you know, technology coming along. And one of the demos they had was they took a Leaf, plugged it into a tiny house, and it can run the tiny house for 2 days off its battery.
Yeah, I read about that. That's a whole different use now for battery storage.
Yeah. So
you can take your car now and start to power your house instead of putting that excess electricity back on the grid. In some places you can actually sell excess electricity back to the grid and make money.
Yeah.
But now a lot of people are moving into these tiny houses, and this is, to me, that's a great use.
Yeah, and it'll run the house for 2 days on a full charge. So there's some things to be said there.
Hyundai. How do you charge the car back up again?
Well, you save enough juice in it to get you to your next few recharge stations.
Yeah, right.
And, you know, and Chris, talking about charging, EVgo and several other charger companies were making a presence at the LA show this year saying, hey, we'll come out and do an assessment at your location to see if you're a good spot to put a commercial charging port at your location.
Charge point, doing charge something point. Like that, yeah. As well. As a matter of fact, I'm trying to get one of our buddies who's with Charge Point now to come on the show. Mm-hmm. And talk a lot about charging stations, since the infrastructure now has to really pick up the pace to satisfy all of these new products coming out.
Yeah. Now, before this image, we had one of the new Palisade from Hyundai. Hyundai has decided, well, yeah, we do need a three-row crossover, but we're not going to call it the Santa Fe anymore. And they have the Palisade. It's a three-row vehicle. They're going to build it in Korea initially. The folks in Montgomery, of course, would love to have it built over here. But they're very proud of this because this is an eight-passenger unit. And they're looking at a vehicle that can really sort of be at the top of their lineup in the SUV large crossover segment, because that's what they don't have right now, that and a pickup truck.
So this is going to be, what, about 50,000 less than a new BMW 7
something like that.
Seven passenger.
Yeah, I'd say 30 to 60,000, yeah.
Because I think the BMW big SUV that they announced was starting at $75,000. Yeah. Did they give any idea what this is going to cost, Craig Palisade?
They didn't talk numbers out the door, but they really talked about appointments, space. They had a demonstration where they actually put adults in the third row. And as we all know, no one wants to be the person in the third row in an SUV these days.
Not me.
And this is an eight-passenger versus a seven-passenger.
Eight-passenger.
So that's a big difference.
And again, speaking about a full electric, Kia showed off the new Soul, which you're seeing here. And this is the fully electric version that you're looking at right now. Think about it. The Kia Soul, which was basically, you know, a little bump off car. And now they're coming with a full electric platform. They'll come up with a hybrid platform eventually. And they're going to have a regular gasoline version. Kia is, again, trying to cover the waterfront, being something for almost everybody. Again, you'll see a lot of innovation coming from these automakers that seem to be nimble and desiring to be able to respond to what the market needs rather than taking 3 to 5 years. Let's do it in 16 to 18 months.
All right.
So it was a fun time. I think the big takeaway is electric cars. They're not coming. They're here. There's a company called Rivian, which I mentioned earlier. Rivian premiered trucks.
I don't know. I thought I had that shot.
I thought it's not. I might not have sent
it. That's okay. Go ahead.
But Rivian has a platform where they can build a light-duty pickup truck capable of pulling 7,100 pounds using the same platform, build a three-row SUV, all on electric power with a range of 400 miles. Yeah, Chris, that was my reaction too.
Yeah.
That's the breaking point.
And aren't they taking deposits now for 2020 deliveries?
Yes, and guess where they're building them? Remember the Mitsubishi plant in Normal, Illinois? They bought it from Mitsubishi, and that's where they're building them. And these guys did a lot of the product development internally as opposed to, you know, outsourcing it to the usual characters. And they've been very low-key. We've had a chance to chat with them. They're a player because even in the last couple of years, we've seen a few folks say, well, we got a truck or an SUV that's all electric and go this far, do 200 miles. But 400 miles, 450 miles, Frank, you pointed out, that's the breaking point.
That's the breaking point. Actually, 300 miles.
That's not the breaking point. That is the buying point.
It's another way of putting it.
Yeah, I always said 350, 325 would be the number where people would start buying electric vehicles. If you can get 400 or 450 miles undisputed, they will sell as many of those as they can get.
Yeah, and now they're talking about a price point of about $61,000 for the SUV.
They'll still sell every one they can make.
All day long and twice on Sunday.
Exactly.
Now, Chris, can you imagine going biking with one of those?
I'd never need to stop and get out the vehicle.
you can go deer hunting, Chris, silent in the woods.
and go way further in the North Georgia mountains, too.
Yeah, right. Craig, you may not want to talk about this, but I'm going to ask anyway. What were some of the behind-the-scenes discussions that you got to participate in? What are some of the car companies exact same behind the scenes?
Well, they were looking at General Motors and saying Mary Barra finally did what needed to be done. That's the first thing. Nobody wanted to talk about it publicly, but the Carlos Ghosn embarrassment, the arrest and the, that's an embarrassment to the Japanese automakers, and they're not feeling comfortable about that at all. And they didn't, that was one of those things like, no, we don't talk about that. He's got cooties type things. And one of the other things, I was talking to some of the tech, the smaller tech companies, the suppliers who provide technology, security, they're looking to become bigger players on the scene, because what they're doing, they're developing this technology in small places instead of the Rensen. And they're what they're saying is, yes, we can make this technology for your brand, but we can also make a similar type for the for your competitor. So it's not going to be whether you're buying a Dodge or a Chevy or a Toyota. It's going to be whose technology you're buying that's going to be in the vehicle you're driving.
Well, I hope that these tech companies focus on security.
Security is a huge issue. The data back and forth.
All of these systems are going to be computerized systems. And one of the largest health providers in my area just was hacked. Not their computers, but the company that they use to store their data.
You're right.
And something like 2.6 million records. Well, 2.6 million people's records were hacked, giving up social security numbers, addresses, and everything else about the people. So security has got to be number one when it comes to these car companies looking at even the hybrids. Because the hybrids now, a lot of those packages in that you find in the car, it's all software.
Yeah. So data is the new fuel. Data is the new cash.
Right. Okay, great. Thanks. Appreciate it, Greg. I know you partied a lot. I know your eyes are red.
And well, let's put it this way. I went to the Fig and had a drink for you.
Oh, thank you. tell Al when I said hi. I hate I missed him. Tell him hello.
Will do.
Same here.
Any closing remarks, guys?
Yes.
What is it, Frank? Go ahead.
Real quick. Sometimes you look at, you can't see the forest because of the trees. And the point of it is, it seems to be this mad dash toward electrification, okay? And nobody looks, at least as yet, nobody has looked at the other side of the story. And that's, when is oil going to run out? Because they know, they've got people that study that all day long, every day. And if there's a rush to perfect electrification, then they know that there's a finite, we all know that there's a finite amount of oil to be produced into petroleum. And I think they have a better grip on when that's going to be. And that's why they're rushing toward electrification.
All right. You heard it first here from Frank Washington.
Don't give him my number.
Yeah, I'm going to give him your email.
As always, folks. If you're watching the replay, click the subscribe button. If you're here on live, click the subscribe button. Check us out on Black Press USA. You can see the show there, as well as on autonetwork.com YouTube channel. In the description of the show, you can find the web addresses of all the journalists here. We are the new and the young and the old auto influencers. You get some of the, what I call, field-tested information here on Auto Network Reports. And as always, please buckle up, don't drink and drive. Buckle up, don't text and drive. And since Frank's here, buckle up, don't stream and drive. See you next time.
Bye.
Bye, guys. Have a good weekend.